for the Deck Lunch Series. I'm Becky Hyde, Product Manager here in the Deck. You can find videos of most of our talks here on our website, humana.io, in the articles section. Feel free to share them with your friends. And check those out if you're not able to make one of our sessions. That's it. So without further ado, I will pass it over to Stephanie Inshallah with Girl Development. Thank you.
Working in Louisville, and I get to travel a lot, so if you're gonna straight like GeoCities 1999, like it was that. And so he was like, well, we're paying this money for you to go to a school, so learn how to build me one. So I did. So I decided to teach myself basic programming. And so I built my dad a website, I built a killer MySpace layout, built myself a website. And then I was like, I'm ready to take on the world. So I quit my job. And I freelanced, and it was great, and I traded a lot. Like, I always had a lot of beer and great hair, because I traded for, like, everything, but I couldn't pay my bills. So then I decided that I needed to get a real job, and I knew that I wanted to develop this as my career. So I applied at Blackstone, and that's where I really cut my teeth. So I got to get a lot of client exposure, a lot of experience with prototyping, strategy, which was really, really cool. And then also, obviously, design, WordPress theming, just really learning the business aspects of it. And then I decided that I wanted to try freelancing again. The second time around was much, much more successful. But I met my CEO, Katie, and we talked for about a year before I decided that I was going to come on board with her. But, you know, the opportunity to work with the Silicon Valley clients in Louisville, Kentucky was something I just couldn't pass up. But so that's kind of how my path has gone. So mine's more self-taught than school. Like my background in school was in art, but self-taught in terms of programming. So one of the questions that that we get often asked is, why do we need female-centric organizations in technology? Like, isn't this kind of a sexist thing? Like, isn't this, you know, if we had a male-oriented group, wouldn't that be outrageous, right? So I want to kind of break down a couple of stats that I think will kind of hit the hammer home. So everyone knows that that tech jobs are high growth. According to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, tech jobs there's a 27% increase in developer jobs that will happen between 2014 and 2024. In general, tech jobs are also high paying. Computing-related jobs constitute 5 of the 10 highest paying jobs among the 30 fastest growing jobs, so high paying careers. And they're also highly flexible. So working remotely is pretty common. However, and while women make up more than half of the professional occupation workforce in the United States, only 25% of women are actually in professional computing occupations in the United States. And only 17% of those women held a C-suite title of CIO. And the diversity problem is pretty staggering, like it's even worse. So only 5% in 2015, only 5% of women working in computer-related fields were Asian American. Only 3% were African American, and the saddest one, just 1% were Hispanic women. So when people ask us, why do we need women-centric tech organizations, and that's because there is this programmer sort of atmosphere that's been created, and programming is better than programming. So I think Steph and I wanted to just talk a little bit about a couple of personal experiences that we face as women in technology.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure that everybody always hears it all the time, that like, you know, there aren't a lot of women in tech, and women face all this adversity, and blah, blah, blah. And it's like sometimes, you know, if you're in a good job and you don't witness that, you can be like, whatever, it's just people complaining. But Shala and I have both had our shared personal experiences in this industry, starting out at college. So I have a minor in fine arts, and it was interesting to go compare the difference between my art classes and my coding classes, because you would walk into an art class and it would be a class of, you know, 90% women and 10% guys. And then you'd walk into coding class and it would be the opposite. I mean, there were classes where I would be the only woman, or maybe, you know, one of two or three women in a class full of guys. And it was intimidating. And, you know, I was nerdy and I didn't care, and I pushed through, and I went to these classes where I was like one of the only girls, and I kind of like fell back on my art a lot. Like all my projects, I would make them super fancy because I was, you know, showing off art skills, I guess, where they were all very focused on the programming. But then once you get out of college, the industry itself is very male-centered too. And I was lucky, like my first first job was half and half on the design and development team. We were two women, two men, and the leader of the team was actually a woman. So I had a great first experience. But working with agencies and working with freelance clients, I've gone through experiences where I'll walk into a client with a man, and even though I'm leading the project, the client will deliberately look at the man in the room and talk to him and give him instructions. And I'll continue to interrupt and be like, well, actually, let me tell you these stats about what you blah, 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 blah. And then they would continue to engage with the other person as though I wasn't leading the conversation and I didn't know what I was talking about. Sometimes I associate that with the fact that I look pretty young too, even though I'm in my 30s. I've been mistaken for a teenager for a very long time. But, you know, that's pretty offensive. I had a boss once tell me that I was too nice to lead a team when I was trying to kind of move up in positions, which is not something he would have ever said to a man. I mean, I could not, and I knew all the guys in my agency, and I knew that they had never had a conversation with him about this before, that you're too nice, you need to, you know, be stronger. My personality hasn't changed since then, and I now manage a U.S. team, so I don't think that was the problem at the time, you know? And where I work now is great. There's a lot of push for women in management, and it's awesome, and I love it. But definitely have experienced it. And Jala, I know you've had experiences as well.
Yeah, definitely. Well, I mean, it starts kind of early on in my life when I was working at my dad's shop, and, you know, and I will never forget it, one guy, and he literally said, "You sure know a lot about computers, but girl," to me, and I was just like, why would you feel like that is an okay thing to say? I don't really understand. I had one boss that consistently called me babe, told me to, work harder, but don't work too hard. Work hard, play hard, babe. And when I left, and he threatened to not pay me, I gave him my lawyer's card, and in turn, he said, well, it's a small town, babe. Watch out for your reputation. Yeah, that was really fun. So where I am now is actually, so our firm is more of a marketing focused firm. So we actually have a lot of women in our firm, and my CEO is also a female. But I will say that our development team, the people who do most of our coding are guys. So I'm definitely looking to hire women to kind of help fill that gap in our own firm. But yeah, I mean, you know, you hear about the disparity in gender bias and technology, and it's definitely true and it's definitely real. So the mission of GDI is really, GDI is really working to kind of level the playing field. And so it's important that we keep these sort of women-centric tech organizations basically to help provide a safe space so that, you know, when I was, for example, learning, I didn't know who to go to with questions. Like I felt embarrassed to ask questions. I remember when I went to school and I registered for one CIS course, and I walked into the class and I wasn't as brave as Stephanie because it was like all dudes, and I dropped the class and I was just like, nope, not gonna be the weird art student in that class. So I think it's really, really important that we have female-centric tech organizations just for these reasons. So we're gonna talk a little bit about the history of GDI and how it got started.
So these two women, Vanessa Hurst and Sarah Chips, by the way, is going to be a keynote speaker at Coca-Cola this year, so if any of you are attending, I highly recommend going to hear her talk. She's currently the CEO of a company called JewelBot, so they do these really cool little learn to code for kids, especially girls, their little bracelets and stuff, like friendship bracelets, which is awesome. She's a really cool girl. But these two, in 2010 in New York, they recognized the problem as well, and they decided to do something about it. So they started a class, just one class, learning to code class, geared just for women, and within 24 hours it sold out. So if that shows you, there's definitely a high demand for female-centric coding, a place where women can go be with other women, feel comfortable, not intimidated, ask questions, things like that. There was obviously a high desire for it, and from there it only grew. GDI now has branches in 56 cities in U.S., and there are over 55,000 members across the country. We should also mention here that though it is girl development and it's female focused, there are also men who are part of the organization, and we welcome especially, you know, we have a lot of male teachers and TAs and mentors, as long as they're, you know, all for the goals of the organization, then, you know, but they always call it we're female inclusive, not exclusive. So it's exploded.
Yeah. So definitely men, if they're interested, there's plenty of ways to get involved. And men are also welcome to come and take the classes. You know, like Steph said, I think it's pretty critical to remember that the GDI itself is again, it's female inclusive, not female exclusive. So there's definitely a lot of men allies in our organization. So the overarching mission of the Pearl Development is that we are a national nonprofit organization, and we exist to provide affordable, judgment-free workshops and classes to women who want to learn web and software development through hands-on instruction. One of the things that really drew me to GDI was the whole hands-on approach. You know, I know that there are a lot of ways to get involved with a self-teaching or self-taught approach. There's a lot of online resources. I taught myself, like I said. But you know, it's really nice to be able to have an actual workshop where you can have an instructor who you can ask questions to. We've been in the industry for a long time now, and if we don't know the answer, you know, get a group of us together and we'll figure something out. So our vision, just to kind of piggyback off of that, is to create a network of empowered women who feel confident in their abilities to code and to build beautiful web and mobile applications. GDI believes that by teaching women around the world from diverse backgrounds to learn software development, we can really help improve women's lives, careers, and their confidence overall. And the core values of GDI, we're committed to making sure that women of all races, all education levels, all income levels, upbringing, no matter what your background is, we want to embrace you and welcome you into our community to help you build confidence in your skill set and to help learn to develop web and mobile applications. So I want to talk a little bit about this kind of cool case study. This is a woman named Kara McLaughlin. And she was a traditional print designer. And when Karen was 52 years old, she lost her job due to industry and economic changes. So Karen discovered Girl Development. She signed up. I think the first class that she took was an intro to HTML and CSS, and decided that she actually really enjoyed the puzzle making, the puzzle piecing process of taking a design and actually building it into code and seeing it come to life. There's something super thrilling about that. I kind of described the first time that I ever got like Hello World or anything to pop up for me on a screen. It's like a junkie almost. Like you just keep chasing that. You just keep chasing that adrenaline rush that you get when it's like, wow, I made this happen. And Karen had that moment. And now she has built in the last 3 years a very successful freelancing business for herself. And she has built over 35 WordPress sites by herself. And this is all like, you know, a lot of people think that if they want to make a career change or they want to advance in their career, they're going to have to go back to school or, you know, I'm in my, you know, doesn't matter how old you are or what education level you're at, GDI wants to help you. So, you know, you don't have to necessarily go back to school and get a traditional four-year degree to have a good job in development. I don't really, when I'm looking for people to hire, I don't really judge their education level as much as I judge can they pass my tests or not, what are their skills like. And so Karen was able to take a really crappy situation, losing what 25 years of her career down the drain in an instant, and she was able to use GDI to help create a new career and a new life for herself.
And then I'm going to talk about Alicia Carr, who... She's not associated with GDI, but she has a story about learning to code that I think is really awesome. She's kind of known online as the tech coding grandma. She was kind of covered in a bunch of news stories a while back. She's got kids. She's got, I think, like 8 grandkids. But in her 50s, she met this 19-year-old, no, he was younger than that. He was like 16, who was insanely rich. And she was like, how did this happen? And he said, I built an app. And I made a bunch of money off of it, and she said, I want to do that. So she went out and she started teaching herself how to code in her 50s. Like I said, had family, had kids, had grandkids. And she took online courses. You know, she would have benefited from something like GDI. And then within 2 years, she built and released her first app, which was called Purple Pocketbook, which, again, another awesome thing about coding is your ability to make a difference in people's lives. And this Purple Pocketbook app was focused towards victims of abuse. It was a resource for people that was kind of a way for them to quietly, secretly, on their own, find resources for getting help with domestic violence. Because she herself had family who had suffered from domestic violence, and she saw this need, and she went out and she made this awesome application to help people. All because she was inspired by this 16-year-old coder. She went out and did it. She made it happen. So, you know, it's just to show that anything is possible. Like, no matter where you are in your career, your age, your life, if you're interested, you can join an organization like GDI to find out if you like coding and get started on a new career path.
So we often get asked, what kind of classes do we offer? Is it just, is it just programming classes? We do offer a lot of programming classes here in the Louisville chapter. Right now, it's just Stephanie and myself who are leading the classes. And being that both of our backgrounds are in front-end development, we're pretty much only offering HTML, CSS front-end dev classes right now. We also offer an Intro to Web Concepts class, which we'll talk about in just a bit. But the national curriculum offers back-end programming classes as well, so things like Angular, Python, PHP. And then additionally, there are also design-oriented classes, so if you are interested in focusing or becoming more of a UX or web designer versus a traditional print designer, we do offer classes for that as well. So basically what we do is we kind of try to cover what any individual would need in order to make a career change or develop a career in design and or development. And we also host some social things too, like we do Code and Coffee, just like some networking events, mixers, things like that. So we do have a couple of classes that are coming up. We have our Intro to Web Concepts class, and so that is super, super basic. It's going to be on June the 24th. It's a two-hour-long class, and it's basically for people who know absolutely nothing about programming or development or how the internet even works. So what we do, a lot of times we'll have like project managers who come and take that class because they're like, I manage this team of developers and I have no idea what he's talking about when he starts talking about Angular and Python and all of these things. And what does that mean? So we teach a good understanding of the vernacular and basically what the difference is between front-end development and back-end development, why each are important, and some other roles that go into mobile and web application development and execution. And then the other workshop that we have coming up, it's actually a two-part workshop. It's going to take place on two Saturdays. It's called Make Your Own Website. Where we make a website about cats, if you want, or you could do a band or whatever you wanted to do. But we teach you how to build your own website from scratch using HTML and CSS. Looking down the road in the fall, we're also looking at teaching some responsive design courses as well, talking about the importance of responsive design, what it is, and how to write media queries, if anybody is familiar with that. I'm sure there's developers here that could help you. So we have kind of a litany of classes that we're working on, but right now it is just Steph and I. We are the only teachers and the only activists and the only community organizers. So we want to talk also about some other ways that you guys can get involved with GDI and help us if you are not necessarily interested in taking classes, but you feel great about the organization. So some other ways to get involved would be.
You can become a teacher or a teaching assistant, please.
A teacher or a teaching assistant. Desperately.
I know there are developers in here. That's especially what we need is help with the back end development. Also, get GitHub, JavaScript, more like deeper into JavaScript, things like that. And again, you can be a guy. You don't have to be a girl to come teach. And it's an awesome opportunity. You can come out. You do get paid, so we're a nonprofit. However, you do get some of the money. money from the tuition. We try to keep our tuitions as low as possible, but we do have to charge some. But yeah, so, and we'll repeat this again later, but if you're interested at all in teaching, please let us know. Please contact us, because we would really love to be able to host more classes. And also being a TA, so TA is a volunteer position, but that's where basically you come in and you just help the students along. So if you have knowledge of HTML, basic HTML and CSS, just very intro level, you can come in, and if a student gets stuck, you know, you can go help them through a problem, things like that. Just be there to support them, talk about your experiences, things like that.
And I think it's worth noting that you don't have to have any prior teaching experience to be involved in becoming a TA in particular. We really help. There's national curriculum that's produced. We'll work with you guys on the presentation of the materials. We will help organizing the class. Like, basically, we do kind of everything for you guys. We just love people to be there to help answer questions and promote the mission.
And it's really fun.
It is fun.
We have really awesome groups come learn, and everybody's super excited and super interested, and they ask a lot of questions, and it's a lot of fun.
So we also welcome people who are interested in hosting and or sponsoring events. So receiving help from the community really enables us to support more students and more teachers. So some things that kind of come to mind that we're always on the lookout for is space for workshops. Snacks are always good, especially when we have our longer workshops. It's nice to have lunch or something provided for the students. We're also looking to start a scholarship fund so that we can help women be able to afford the classes. While we try to keep the classes relatively affordable, like our HTML and CSS, it's an eight or nine hour workshop. I can't remember off the top of my head, and it's $100. So it's affordable. $100 is a lot of money to a lot of people. So we're looking to start a scholarship fund to help bridge that gap. So that cost is not a barrier for women who might be interested in coming to our classes.
You can also go to the GDI website, the national site, and make a donation there and specify that you want it to go to the Louisville chapter, and then that money comes to us, and we can use that for scholarships or for buying food for our friends and things like that.
We're also super open to having people help us with community outreach, so just helping spread the word, spread our mission, raise awareness, help us recruit instructors, like if you guys have friends that you think might be interested in helping us out, you know, please do send them our way. If you guys have experience running social media campaigns, we could definitely use some help with running better social media campaigns. If you guys want to help us represent GDI at local community events, just basically be a loud mouth and help us spread the word and get the word out about our organization.
Maybe a good time to note that if you haven't noticed, I'm currently pregnant with my second child, so I'm going to be out of commission for a few months, especially towards the end of this year. So having those event organizers to help when I'm out of commission, especially because, again, it's Ashala and I, would be amazing. So if you or if anyone you know would be interested, even in just stepping in for a month or two, if you don't have a lot of time but you want to be involved for a little while, let us know. We'd love to have you.
Yeah. Or if you want to alternatively help us organize events, like for the Coke and Coffees or any mixers, we'd love to have a hackathon. We haven't done one here in Louisville yet, but we think that would be really fun to do. Fundraisers, whatever you can think of in terms of, you know, a traditional community or event organizer role. And then obviously if you guys have other ideas on how we can promote the message and get people involved, we're definitely open to hearing about that. These are our email addresses. Don't rush to write them down. I'll have them on the last slide too, so you can find us then. And you can also find us on social media. So like I said, we could probably use some help like doing Twitter or Instagram or any other social media outlets. But right now we're pretty active on Facebook. So we not only post information about upcoming classes and workshops and where we're gonna be, but we also share a lot of content that is about women in technology, ways to get involved, interesting stories, things like that. And then all of our classes are posted on Meetup too, so you can find us on Meetup and register for workshops and our classes that way as well. that's it. So, do you have anything else to say?
GDILouisville.com is another place that'll take you to our page on the national site, which has information about Shal and I, our contact information, and links to the meetup groups. So, if you can remember, just GDILouisville.com. But yes, your email addresses if you want to get in touch with us that way.
All right, thank you. Thank you guys very much. That we get asked a lot, especially because the name would imply that it is for younger women. The organization itself does not. The organization itself is geared for women 18 and up, but we are definitely interested. I'm a graduate of Presentation Academy, so I went to all girls school. I've done some speaking engagements there for the girls. We're definitely interested in helping get younger girls interested in programming development. But one of the cool things that I also think about GDI is that, you know, there are a lot of organizations out there that are trying to get younger, like middle school and high school age girls involved in technology and programming, but there's not a lot of organizations that are geared to people who might be interested in making a career change or something like Karen on the site that we're looking at earlier. So it's kind of, it's just working to help create that opportunity for women who might be a little bit older too, who haven't been exposed to it previously. So, personally, yes, I love that, and that's a huge mission of mine, but for the organization itself, it's just 18 and up. Any other questions?
It's actually, well, it started out pretty even, but last week I feel like there were a lot of the girls work there, and I don't know if they dropped out or what. So those are the primary differences.
Any other questions? Thank you guys again so much for letting us come out here and talk. We hope that you've learned some stuff and sparked some excitement about getting more women interested in programming.